or accidentally leave uncovered your tracks. But we need now some way of representing structures like this. Up until now, the only kinds of data structures we've had are things like chars and ints and floats and slightly more fancy arrays. But even an array has just been a contiguous sequence of ints or chars. But what if we actually want to represent something like a table like this, or a file, or maybe even more familiarly, a student? And a student might have a name and an ID, or you can imagine any number of real world entities that would be nice to kind of represent with your new custom data type. So we can actually do this. So this is a file this week called struct.h. And notice what you can do here. There's a new keyword that we've actually seen before, but we're using it now proactively for the first time, called typedef, and another one called struct. And even though this is slightly new syntax, what this chunk of code means is declare a new type, similar in spirit to int and float, but a custom one, whose structure looks like that. Inside of apparently a struct that's going to be called student is an integer called ID, a string called name, and a string called house. So I could literally write string, but again, I'm trying to take off the training wheels of the CS50 library. But this here means give me a new variable type called student, inside of which are three things. Now, why is this useful? Well, let me open up this file, structs1.c. If I scroll down here, notice a couple of things. One, I'm kind of including some familiar, friendly things because I want to use getString and some other stuff, printf and the like. But notice this too. Now that I have my own header file, as we've had in some of our own psets, I have to include my own file. And anytime you're including a file you wrote, you use quotes. Anytime you're using a file someone else wrote, you use angled brackets. So that's the one subtlety there. I'm apparently using this trick called a constant so that the total number of students in this program is 3. And let's, before we look at the code, just look at what this thing's going to do. So this is structs 1. So let me go into my code and do make structs 1. Let me go ahead and run structs 1. All right, so a student's ID is 1. Student's name is David. Mather, student's ID is 2. Let's say this is Rob. This is Kirkland. And 3, this is Matt. This is Kirkland. OK, that's the only thing I did with this program, right? David's in Mather. So how did we do this, right? So clearly, we threw away 2/3 of the information we collected here. But what's actually going on? How did I store these? Now, to take a step back, you could totally implement this program in like week 1, right? You could have 9 variables, student ID 1, student name 1, student house 1. Then you could have student ID 2, student house 2, student name 2. And then you could just kind of come up with some arbitrary convention like numbering your variables. But you'd have 9 of them. And conceptually, this should hopefully start to rub you the wrong way. This is a little inelegant. Just to store 3 real-world entities like teaching staff, I now need 9 variables, and I need to give them all separate names. I'd kind of like to have a variable called student 1, student 2, student 3, something super simple, inside of which are the nitty-gritty details. So that's exactly what we're doing here. Notice if I scroll down to my main program here, notice in my main function, I first declare an array of students. And I can now use jargon that just sounds more natural to me. I want a student data variable. I'm going to call this a class of students. And how many do I want? Well, this is just 3. Remember that we hard-coded that up above. So this means give me an array of 3 students and call that array class, which is just kind of consistent with the idea. Here's a for loop that iterates from 0 to 3. And then I just use some familiar functions. I use getInt and getString and getString. But notice the syntax. This is one new piece of syntax, and that's it. To get the ith student in the class, I do class bracket I. But if I want to go inside of that student structure and say, edit its ID number, I just say dot, or I say dot name, or I say dot house. So this is a way of kind of clumping up together multiple variables, an int, a char star, a char star, but thinking of them and programming them as though they're one bigger entity, like a student, but still having access to all the nitty-gritty details. So here's how only I was printed. If I iterate then over all of these students again in the array, recall this function, string comparison. So if the ith students in the class house equals quote unquote Mather, and I check that by checking for equal to equal to 0. Remember, that's what the string comparison does. It says 0 if they're equal. I print out David or whoever is in Mather. And how do I get at David's name? Class bracket I .name. But there is one thing I have to do now to get into this habit. Notice at the very bottom, and I had this in my last example, I call free. Free is the opposite of malloc. Any time you call malloc, it is up to you, and it's expected of you, to call free at some point. Not right away, because that would kind of defeat the purpose, but eventually, before you actually exit your program or return from main. So what I'm doing here is I'm freeing name and house for all three students, but I'm not freeing ID. Why? Because what? Oh, I think you're right. I just can't hear you. Okay. Oh, so okay. So I didn't print it, but why did I make a conscious decision not to free ID? I didn't use malloc. It's as simple as that. Because in my H file, notice my header file, because in my header file I said that a student is an int and a char star and a house, notice there's no malloc here, but I did assign to name and house the return value of what function? GetString. GetString uses malloc. And so here, too, is this dirty little secret that I admitted to earlier. All this time, we've been writing technically buggy programs. But the upside is, my god, we didn't have to think about or talk about pointers in the first week. We could just use GetString and get a string from the user. But now, anytime you call GetString, which will soon be no more, or ultimately call malloc, you have to free memory. Otherwise, your program will, quote unquote, leak. And that generally results in slowdowns, and it ultimately involves incorrectness of programs. So I thought I would disclose or emphasize all the more with a concrete example what is and is not possible in popular culture in terms of technical shows like this. So I dug out a 30 or so second clip from an actual TV show. We'll then counterbalance it with what really would happen had they consulted anyone remotely technical before shooting this episode. So here we go.
Go back one.
What do you see?
Bring his face up, full screen.
His glasses.
There's a reflection.
That's the Nuevitas baseball team. That's their logo.
And he's talking to whoever's wearing that jacket.
Okay. So anytime you hear someone say again, can you clean that up? Can you enhance that? You can't. If you see a little glimmer in someone's eye, for instance, Rob's, and you try to zoom in on that little white speck of some reflection there, as I can do with some consumer program, let's call it Photoshop. Let me drag suspect.jpg into Photoshop. I'm going to zoom in on something suspicious here in his eye, and I'm going to zoom, and I'm going to zoom, and I'm going to zoom. Okay, so that glimmer in his eye, as well as CSI's eye, 2 pixels of color. This is what happens when you enhance an actual image in reality. So I give you Rob Bowden's eye. This is CS50, end of week 5. We will see you next week.